Hello, welcome back to Scaffold Design for Scaffolders. I'm Alejandro Garcia, and today we will talk about buckling. Now, this is a very important subject because if a scaffold is too much loaded, it will not fail because we have reached the maximum capacity of the material, of the steel usually, but because of buckling. Now, I am going to explain only buckling due to an axial load. Buckling can also be caused by shear loads on thin plates, for example, but I'm not going to explain that failure. So, what's an axial load? Well, as you can imagine, an axial load, it's a load that is acting along the axis of a structure, or an upright, a layer. If you remember from the very beginning, we said that loads or forces can only push or pull. So, if we have an axial load pushing an upright, for example, that's compression. If it's pulling, it's tension. For compression, just think a column in a building or an upright supporting the scaffold load. And for tension, you can just have a cable with a load, or just a suspended scaffold. That's another example where you have the uprights in tension. What is buckling? Buckling is the sudden deformation of a column under a compressive load that is below the material's capacity. So imagine we just have a long column with a compressive load on top. If it fails due to buckling, it will deform or will bend in a similar shape. Now, buckling has been under study for centuries. It began during the second half of the 15th century. There was an Italian genius called Leonardo da Vinci, probably you heard about him, and he said that buckling, depending on the length of the column. So the longer the length or the height of the column, the lower the critical load. We call critical load the maximum load a column can support before buckling. That's critical load. Then also Galileo Galilei studied the problem, but it was during the 18th century, at the end of the 18th century, that a Swiss mathematician, Leonhard Euler, solved the problem mathematically and created a simple and easy to use formula. And it's this one. Euler's buckling formula, it's critical load equals pi to the second times elastic modulus times the second moment of area divided by the effective length to the second. Now, the effective length equals a coefficient k times L. Now, it's important to remember that the second moment of area is the minimum. Every shape will, if we consider just two axes, it will have two different second moment of areas. Whatever axis has the lowest second moment of area, in that direction is where the buckling will happen. Now, if we just input the values from Euler's formula on a graph, We'll see that up to an Snellen ratio of 93.9, I will explain later what it is, we have buckling. Below that ratio, the material will fail because it reaches the material's capacity. So in our case, the 235 megapascals. Now you see this formula, this equation here, is basically this load over area. So it's the critical compressive or the critical compression. And if you multiply these values at the end, you get with this division here. Now, radius of duration is equal to the square root of the second moment of area divided by the area. Now it's kind of an equivalent. So it's how far must be this area from the axis to obtain the same second moment of area. If you remember, we said second moment of area equals area times distance to a second. So just going back to that, A times R squared. So if we just want R, we have that R equals I over. Okay, that's the radius of duration. And we are going to use it always to see what point of the graph, I mean, it's buckling or not, and to calculate the critical load. Effective length. Now we are going to check four different cases with different conditions, pin connections, pin fix, etc. So we are always going to consider slender column with a load on top. Now, remember that effective length equals K, a coefficient, times the length. Now, what are those coefficients? Let's start with a pin-pin connection. We will have all the columns with length L. Now, if we put a compressive load on top of the column, it will bend like this, forming an arch. So in this case, we say that K equals 1. Now, the question will be, why 1? Well, because then what we consider the length, the buckling length, is length of half sine wave, or to make it easier, a sine wave is just like the waves of the sea. So we have a crest and a through, crest, through, crest, through. So we call a wavelength the distance from starting the crest to the next one. So we are taking as buckling length half of sine the wave, or if you want, the crest of a sea wave. So we are taking as the buckling length this length here. Okay, that's going to be our buckling length. And why with the sine wave? Well, this is due to the resolution of the equation by Euler 300 years ago. So just remember, we are just considering the crest of the wave. And you will see right now the other examples. It will make more sense. Now, this is a fixed column, and it deflects differently. Okay, so it's going to have like a smaller arch in the center. So we that's 0.5. So our k equals 0.5. This is a fixed pin connection. It's another bending with 0.7. And then we have just a fixed free column. And this is 2. Why 2? Because we require the crest of the wave. So if we just consider the length above ground level, we just have half. If we go from here, we only have half of the wave. So we need double to make one crest of the wave. Now I'm going to show you the real deformation of a slender column. Give me a second to move my chair. Now, I have this piece of cardboard, and I'm going to show you the different support conditions of the column, so you see how the real deformation is. Now, before, remember, Euler's formula is pi squared times the elastic modulus times the second moment of area. Now, it's important to remember that it's always the minimum second moment of area. I mean, the column will buckle where it will have less resistance against buckling, and that's going to happen where the second moment of area is smaller. Last week we calculated the second moment of area according to both axes of the section. So whatever axis has a smaller second moment of area, that will be the axis where the column will buckle. So for example, this is just a rectangle. It's wide on this side and thin on this one. So where do you think it's going to buckle? So if I try on the thinner section, so I mean I have more area on this against, I mean away from the computer, it's not bending at all. If I try parallel to the computer, it's bending. Okay? Just because the second moment of area is much less. Now, let me show the four conditions you have seen on the screen. Now, I'm going to start with the pin-pin connection. So if you remember, pin-pin connection, it doesn't move, but it can rotate. This one is very important because for tube and fitting scaffold, we will consider pin joints. So I'm just supporting it, but it can rotate. Now I apply a compressive load. You see how it bends? So it's just, this is the crest of the wave, I said before, okay? So we have the crest, therefore we say that our coefficient k equals 1. Now let's go with, for example, fixed pin connection. So I'm going to fix down here, and this one, as before, I'm just supporting. Let me see. See? It's slightly different. Down here where it's fixed, there is a piece that is straight, and then it's bending. This one is k equals 0.7. Now let's go with fixed. So it cannot rotate on top or bottom. See? That's three. We have the weight in the center. So here we have a k equals 0.5. And the last one is fixed free. See? Well, it's bending by itself. So if I apply the load, it's going to deflect. Now since we consider the effective, I mean, the backing length, the crest of the wave, here we only have half of the crest, so we need another half. That's why in this condition, our coefficient k equals 2, because we have to double this shape to get the full length of the crest. Let's do an example now. Calculate the critical load of a scaffold tower with 2 meter fully braced leaves using Euler's formula. Remember, this is Euler's formula, so we're just going to insert the values to obtain the critical load. Now, pi square, I mean 3.14 to the second. Elastic modulus for steel, 210,000 newton per millimeter square. And the second moment of area. We have already calculated it on previous videos, so just write it here. 137,676. And this is divided by effective length to the second. The effective length is the coefficient k times the length. In this case, pin pin k equals 1 times the length is 2000 millimeters to the second. And that's equal to 71,337 newtons or 71.3 kilometers. Okay, that's with Euler's formula. As you will see later, the real capacity of the upright is going to be smaller. But this is a quick guide, and we still use Euler's formula on TE20 Eurocodes, you will see. Okay, now I'm just going to show you different graphs to see how the backlink calculation has evolved since Euler's times. So we are going from Euler up to the Eurocode 3 for steel. That's where TE20 obtains the critical loads from. So this is from Euler, from 1744. It's the same you saw before. So we have backlink up to a slenderness ratio of 93.9, and then it fails by crashing. Now, in the 19th century, there were other formulas obtained, especially with testing. They tested different types of shapes of steel, iron, etc. So I'm just showing three here. Rankine from 1862, Marais Barba, and Johnson. Johnson just made a small curve to avoid that flat line we had before with Euler. So basically what this curve was saying is that the columns are always failing in buckling. Now, those are the Eurocode 3 curves that we use today. And just for reference, I have left Johnson and Barré-Marva. As you see, basically all the Eurocode curves are in between those two. So they weren't too far apart. Now, Eurocode has different curves because it considers different sections. Depends if you have a square, you have an HGB profile, etc. And from these five curves, A0 to D, we are only concerned with curves A and C. Curve A is for hot finish hollow sections and C for cold form hollow sections. We are only going to use from now on C, because that's the one on T20, 21, and for the very good reason that I haven't found any supplier in the UK selling hot form hollow sections for scaffold uprights. So we are always going to use curve C of TE20. I mean, of Eurocode, that is the same on TE20. Now, if you remember with Euler, there was from 93.9 slenderness ratio up to 235, we had a flat line. So those were the columns that will fail because they reach the maximum capacity of the material. As you see here, after many years of testing, now we only have failure of the uprights in this area, up to a slenderness ratio of 18.8. And how much is that? This is roughly 295 millimeters. Okay? That's why I said before, if a scaffold fails because it has too much load, it's going to fail due to buckling, never because the material will fail. Now, are we going to use this graph? Or what's no? T20 makes our life easier, and they have already calculated the values we are going to use for the scaffold design. So, what's the axial load capacity we are going to apply? Well, this is all from section 5.6, where we have the formula from Eurocode. That you have, well, is this the same graph you have seen before? I mean, inputting numbers on the equations, you get different values and you can draw the curve. So I'm just going to show it to you. I will make an example, but it's just so you know about the formula. I mean, you see it somewhere, you can identify it, you know what's going on, but it will not be so difficult as you will see with the example. Now, T20 requires that every scaffold component has a factor of safety of 1.65. So we start by dividing the critical load by 1.65. And the critical load is equal to a coefficient P times the area times the yield capacity of the steel. That capacity is, I mean, is reducing the capacity of the material due to the buckling, is this coefficient 1 over phi plus the square root of phi minus lambda. This is how we obtain phi, is another with lambda again, and this is lambda. Now if you see, we have on the top area times the yield capacity, so basically is the maximum capacity of the material on compression, area times Fy, and below we have the critical load, Euler's critical load. And then if you just operate, you get this coefficient, this equation. Now, And then, yeah, alpha is going to be 0.49 for curve form, that's curve C, or 0.21 for curve A, but we will always use 0.49. Now, let me just do an example just to show the numbers are also to explain where the values you will check on TE20's tables come from. So we are doing the same example, but this time using TE20's formula. So we start as before, the critical load divided by 1.65. We have to find coefficient and phi and lambda. So I will go from bottom to top. Effective length is going to be the 2 meters because for pin connection, k equals 1. So 1 times the length. So we have 2000 millimeters divided by R. R is radius of gyration equals the square root of second moment of area divided by A. And that's, if you input the values, 15.72 millimeters. Yes. And that's pi square times 210,000 and this is divided by 235 newtons per millimeter. And that's equal to 1.354. Now here is just inputting the values. We have 0.5 times 1 plus 0.49 times lambda is 1.354 minus 0.2 plus 1.354 squared. And that's equal to 1.70. And then, if we apply the values here, we just get 1.70 plus square root 1.7 square minus 1.354 square. And that's 0.36. And finally, it's just applying this coefficient times the maximum capacity of the material. So the area is, remember, 557 millimeter square times 235 Newton millimeter square. And that's 29,114 newtons or 29.1 kilonewton. Okay. It's just an example to show you all the equations involved, but you will not need to do this process every time you design a scaffold. We have these tables on TE20 that for every effective length, they provide the critical load with the factor of 1.65. So, what's the safe axial load for the type 4 scaffold tube? If you check TE20, table 5.10, we have these tables. I have expanded it. I have given more values than on the table. So I have marked 2 in green because they will be the most common ones on your designs, probably. So if you check at the bottom, we have 2000 millimeters effective length and the safe axial load of 29.1 kilonewton. Okay, exactly the same value I just calculated using all the equations from Eurocode. Another important number to remember is for effective length of 3.2 meters. That's 13.6 kN. Why it's important? Because if we tie the scaffold at 4 meter intervals in vertical, the effective length of the scaffold will be 3.2 meters. So, two numbers to remember. 2 meter effective length, 29.1 safe axial load. If you have a 3.2 meter effective length, the safe axial load is 13.6. So now, just a couple of exercises so you can practice at home. Number one, calculate the critical load of a 3 meter strut, a type 4 tube, using Euler's formula and compare your result with TE20's table. And two, calculate again the critical load using Euler's, but for the other three support conditions, fixed, fixed pin, and fixed free. Okay, that's all for now. Obviously, don't forget Euler's formula. And oh yeah, that's all. I just want to thank, not exercises, I just want to thank especially Jeff Henson. He has a great YouTube channel of mechanics of materials. So I learned a lot on his lesson 66 about buckling. And Lucas Scottney, his business interface has a very good blog with very nice explanation of buckling. So thanks again for watching this video. Please let me know if anything is not clear. Put me comments under the video. Please also don't forget to click like and subscribe to the channel so you don't miss any videos in the future. Thank you very much. Bye bye.